Welcome back. This is Kim Saeed of KimSaeed.com. And in today's video, I'm going to be answering the burning question that I see all over the internet. And that is, how can I be sure that someone is 100% narcissist? Make sure you stay till the end because I'm going to be sharing some really helpful links for you. And if you haven't subscribed yet, make sure you do that right now. Just click the little bell because that is going to tell YouTube to notify you when I publish a new video. Otherwise, you'll never know. So on to today's video. How can I be sure they are 100% narcissist? Okay, so the first thing we want to cover is, what do you really think being 100% narcissist would look like? If you look back in history, even the most horrific serial killers were not always 100% evil. So we can't really go by the fact that sometimes someone is appearing to be somewhat kind or nice. Narcissists have all kinds of tricks in their bag that they use to fool you into thinking that maybe they're just a tortured soul who needs your special kind of love and understanding. This is why it is so commonly known that narcissists tend to prey on empathic people or empaths, because empaths who haven't really successfully implemented their boundaries yet or learned how to protect their energy are often easier targets for narcissistic people. And by the way, no judgment, because I have been that way for most of my life. I have since learned to put up boundaries against anything that drains my energy, and in situations where I do need to be there for someone, I have learned how to protect my energy, to ground myself, and also how to cleanse and purify my aura or my energy field afterwards. What does being 100% narcissist even look like? There's really no way to tell. I think where a lot of people get confused is when they're going through checklists, and there are some good ones and there are some not so good ones out there. I would generally recommend using the DSM criteria, but that's really just a scratch on the surface. It doesn't really tell you exactly how they use those particular traits to abuse people. It just says how they are. So if you're looking at someone, you're trying to figure out, are they really a narcissist? Or are they 100% narcissist? It doesn't really matter. What we need to start realizing is we don't need to slap a label on someone to justify leaving a relationship. And I'm talking about any kind of relationship, whether it is a romantic partner, a friend, a family member, a coworker, and sometimes, unfortunately, people do have to break free from their own family members. Because someone has shown seeming moments of kindness or consideration does not mean that they were sincere during those times. And it also doesn't mean that because they were nice last week when they fixed you a pasta dinner, that they're not an abusive narcissist. A lot of narcissists are very generous and caring and considerate until you start trying to put up boundaries or until you start pointing out the things that they're doing. And the reason they become angry is because they want to condition you not to bring up the fact that they have been cruel or abusive. So what that might look like in practical measures is, if someone has repeatedly lied to you, if someone has been unfaithful to you numerous times and they keep making promises that they're going to stop and then you find out they never stopped, or maybe they're extremely verbally and emotionally abusive and they particularly do this when it's just the two of you alone together. What that might look like is, you know, some some of the more garden variety types of narcissists don't care about their appearance. So they might act a little wacky just checking out at the grocery store with you. They might say things that are really kind of unacceptable to you right in front of someone. Usually it's someone who the narcissist deems as lower than they are. So in those cases, they might feel a little more comfortable showing their true colors. And really it's to make you feel ashamed. But not all narcissists do that. A lot of times they look like the pillar of their community. They might do a lot of volunteer work, which is called the altruistic narcissist. But behind closed doors, you get this really weird vibe from them, and that's when they feel comfortable being verbally and emotionally abusive. That's where they tend to shame you. So we don't need a label in order to break free from a relationship. You want to start looking at how the relationship makes you feel on a regular and continuous basis. And I like to compare it to a climate. What is your relationship climate? Do you have mostly sunny skies, maybe a little wind here a couple times a month, maybe a tsunami a few times a year, and things are resolved in a respectable and reciprocal manner? Everyone cools off and comes back together as friends and as respecting partners or friends or whatever the case may be. But if it's the opposite, if there are volcanoes, you know, erupting every other day and you're constantly putting out fires and there are tsunamis and hurricanes going on all the time, but you had one day or 2 days during the month where things seemed a little smooth, you don't want to focus on the 2 days. That is how we get ourselves into trouble, is when we are not able to really look at the reality of the situation. So if someone is really, really awful 90% of the time, you don't want to focus on the 10%, because the thing you need to keep in mind is that most often, the nice times when the narcissist seems like they're being kind or considerate or generous, that is an integrated part of the abuse. That's what causes the cognitive dissonance. It's what causes you to doubt yourself and to doubt whether or not they're actually abusive. It kind of ties into that intermittent reinforcement, or as I like to call it, the hurt and rescue cycle. So they go along, they're doing really hurtful things, they're giving you the silent treatment, they're lying, they're cheating, and then all of a sudden they come back, "Oh honey, I just can't make it without you. You're in my blood. I can't imagine my life without you. Please come back. I promise things are going to be different this time. I promise I'm going to treat you the way you deserve." Does that sound familiar? It probably does. Now, there are a small percentage of narcissistic people who don't do the romantic Hoover, but most of them do, because we as empaths, or as compassionate and caring people, want to be able to see and believe that there is good in everyone. But that's not always the case. If you've ever heard me talking about cognitive empathy, or maybe you've read one of my articles that I wrote on it, cognitive empathy is a very dangerous kind of empathy that narcissists use to get inside your head. Find out what your deepest dreams, desires, and also your deepest fears are, your deepest wounds, so that they know better how to hurt you. Cognitive empathy is used by torturers, cult leaders, and even car salesmen. So when you think the narcissist is being nice or kind, it's usually a charade. So you definitely want to keep those things in mind. So the question is not, are they 100% narcissist? The question should be, how do I feel inside this relationship on a regular basis? What is the relationship climate? Now, a person who truly cares about you is not going to try to shame you. Another way that you can gauge whether someone is exhibiting narcissistic traits is things were super romantic, fun, exciting, and adventurous in the beginning of the relationship, and you felt like you had this connection that you had never ever felt with anyone else. And then that lasted maybe 3 to 6 months or so, and then all of a sudden, the little digs about your appearance, the way you dress, maybe you've put on a few pounds. A person who truly cares about you and considers you a friend or a lover, they're not going to make you feel ashamed. Some may even feel, you know, a little closer to you. Maybe they feel like, you put on a few pounds, so that means you're really happy in the relationship. That happens a lot. So a relationship with a narcissist is really fun and exciting and cool in the beginning, and then over time, you feel less of yourself, you feel less confident, you feel less attractive, and even less intelligent. You start to feel like people that you have known in your whole life suddenly are looking at you in a different light. Now, that may be true. There might be some people close to you who are looking at you when you're talking about your relationship and they're like, oh my God, I can't even believe you're telling me this. And maybe you're acting as though, well, I can't really tell if it's really that bad. And your friend's looking at you like, what? That means you have started to normalize the abuse and to normalize the dysfunction. That is a blueprint dynamic of a narcissistic relationship. Also, keep in mind that in a regular relationship with non-disordered people, the beginning of the relationship might be fun, but you might not have a connection right away. It might take a little while for you to build up a friendship. And then as time goes on, you feel more comfortable with that person. You feel better about opening up. They're not ridiculing you. They're not using your deepest fears and desires and dreams and wishes against you. They're not using the things you told them as ammunition to break you down. So those are the things you really want to focus on, not whether someone is 100% narcissist, because look at people like Hitler. Look at the things he did, but he reportedly did not drink alcohol. I don't know. There are so many different theories and stories out there, but according to one of his personal assistants, he didn't even eat meat. He didn't like the slaughter of animals. So there you have it. Those are the things you should be looking at instead of focusing on whether someone is 100% narcissist. Because someone might seem to have one or two good traits, doesn't make them a good person. Start tracking and monitoring your relationship climate just like you do the weather. And then after a few weeks, sit down and figure out what is the reality of the situation. Have you started to normalize abusive behaviors? Are you trying to make excuses and justify someone's bad behaviors towards you because you have that dream, that wish that the relationship might work out somehow? You've got to remember that we have to deal with the trauma bonding and we have to deal with the biochemical addictions. That's what makes leaving so difficult. But once you get out and you start to heal, you'll begin to realize that everything was lies, chaos, and basically just a circus. So there you have it. What if they're not 100% narcissists? After watching this video, if you feel like your relationship is toxic, make sure you check the links down in the description box below, because I've included lots of really helpful links for you to help you start moving forward and detaching from painful relationships. And I'll see you in the next video.